So let me ask you about that, the long-term investing approach, because you have repeatedly pointed on that as the single metric for both institutional investor and the retail investor. You also outlined that good companies.
Yes.
So what differentiates a good company and a bad company? You sound a lot like a private equity investor here, that Shreeja, we are long-term investors and use the word long-term, investing for 7 years, 8 years, but that is their business model. As somebody who's constructing a stocks portfolio for a mutual fund, I think it's a combination of both art and science. Art is intuition, that is up to you, that is the Kalpen Parekh's magic or your team's magic that is coming, it's subjective. But tell me about the science. What are the filters that you apply when you go for a stock?
Okay, so let me take it one step at a conceptual level. It doesn't matter whether we are investing in a listed stock where I can enter today and in 2 minutes get out also, versus buying a private company today, and because of the nature that it is not listed, I end up being stuck for 7 or 10 years. The principles of investing will not change. Whenever I'm allocating or giving capital to a company or a stock, effectively I'm becoming an owner of that business. So you are an entrepreneur now, right? How will you keep thinking about your business? That if you have put 100 rupees of capital, let's assume you had not started this business and you had put this capital in a Government of India bond. You would have earned 8% without any effort, risk-free, sovereign bond. Over the next 10, 20 years, you would earn 7 to 8% return. So if your own business does not compensate you more for the risk you are taking, for the efforts you are putting, and normally one says that you know, if your return on your capital is 2 times of the cost of capital in the country or the other alternative safe investment, unless it is not that, it's not a great business. So that takes you to the concept of return on capital, or we use return on equity as a concept. So if ROEs are around 14 to 15% is a threshold for us. We say that if, you know, we don't like companies which are not earning a double digit, high double digit return on equity. So, you know, we have a well-defined actually investment philosophy document on our website where we've listed down the quantitative metrics. So apart from the artist, you know, bringing their judgment about trends in the industry or trends in a company or judging a management or
corporate governance,
and a lot of these things don't need only judgment today. You know, if you can see through accounts, we have a forensic analyst whose job is to just see that the accounts are matching, the cash flow statement and the P&L statement are actually talking to each other and tallying. If they don't tally, whatever the management may say, there is a governance gap, and hence you don't invest in those companies then. But we have a well documented framework of 10 to 12 pages where we say that our preference is for companies with 16% return on equity. Our preference is for companies which over a full cycle grow their profits at least by 12 to 14%. Our preference is for companies which don't need a constant capital infusion to be in business, because then it is a capital inefficient business, ROEs will come down. So we like companies which do not need debt to run. From their own cash flows, they can reinvest and run the business. Our preference is for managements which can understand the volatility of the world in their industries and navigate and take the right decisions. So that's a very simple framework which quantitatively can help you in identifying a group of such companies. So today when you look at any portfolio of a DSP fund, the ROE of that portfolio, aggregate ROE across all those 40-50 stocks will be 18 to 20%. So basically that is a very simple starting point, that the company or the business should be earning enough return on capital. That's the first principle. The second principle, tactically, you know, once in a cycle, there are companies at lower ROE than our threshold, but either there is a management change or that industry is changing, going through a cycle change, and the industry is coming out of a downturn. And if we are able to get them that turning point right, or those triggers right, a company moving from 8% ROE to 14% ROE also can make a lot of money. Because when it is at 8% ROE, most people would not be owning it. Valuations will be very, very cheap. But if you get that transition, you get the profit growth as well as the valuation re-rating. And the third important dimension is, now these two are in a way very simple. And in today's world, you can go to many digital tools and, you know, screen for these type of companies. It's very easy. A layman can also do that. And which is why most of these companies are fully priced. Companies with high ROEs are also at high valuations. There is very limited free lunch available. So how do you value these companies to say that, is this the fair value of the company, or is the company's fair value much lower than the market cap? So let's say the market cap is 2 lakh crores, but the fair value of the company, keeping everything in mind, is only 1.6 lakh crores. Then I'm overpaying. It may have high ROEs, It may have reasonable growth, but the market has already discounted next 10 years of growth in the price. Then I will pay for a great company, I will overpay, and for 3-4 years the stock will go nowhere. Today it's happening with banking stocks, it's happening with consumer stocks. In many cases, you know, they all became expensive 3-4 years back. So they are going through a period of price consolidation. The businesses are still great, they are growing, but the stock has stopped growing. So these are three things that broadly you keep in mind. High ROE companies, companies shifting ROE gears, companies having profit growth in double digit, and they are available at, ideally if they are available cheap, great. But you know, great companies available cheap is a great anomaly. It is available, these conditions happen very, very rarely. It will happen in a 2008 crisis, it will happen in a COVID crisis, but on those days the headlines are so negative that you lose all sense of rationality, and only such investors are able to exploit these anomalies. So I think it's very simple, whether you're doing private investing, public investing, these are some of the simple frameworks that we bring to work. Actually, you know, and why do we say long term? Even 7 or 8 years is not long term, because you know the real benefit of money multiplying, our capital, our savings multiplying. We have a fund called the DSP Flexicap Fund. It is our oldest fund. We launched in 97 at 10 rupees, like every fund is launched at 10 rupees, right? It has grown at 18%, 19% CAGR, very good returns in today's times, over now 27 years. I think the NAV today would be closer to 1000 rupees. So it's almost a 100 bagger. Now it's a 100 bagger not because of 18%. It's a 100 bagger because it is 18% over 27 years. So 27 years is the hero message, not just 18%. If you have 1 crore today and forget 18%, this fund earned 18% because in 97 equity markets were not discovered. We were closer to single digit valuations. Some of the best companies of India of today were that time at single digit valuations or close to 10-12 multiple. Today they are at 30-40. So today unlikely we are going to make those type of returns. Most likely we will make 10-12% return. 1 crore invested at 12% in 30 years becomes 30 crores. The same 1 crore at the same 12% return, if you just extend the time horizon to 75 years, assuming I want to invest for my next generation, what should the number be? So 1 in 30 years is 30 crores. So that same 1 in 75 years should be what? The answer is 4,900 crores.
Wow.
So that's the power of length of time. Because this 30 crores in the next 7 years will become 60 crores. And in the next 14th year will become 120. And then the compounding snowball effect starts. Which is why investing has to be a function of our goals. If my goal is short term, this 75 year story has no meaning, right? If I want to buy a house next year, then I have to think from a 1 year lens. Then I should not think of compounding. I should just think that my money is invested at 7-8% in a safe bond so that 1 year from now I can take it out. Irrespective of what happens to markets, this money is safe. But if part of my goal is a better retirement, part of my goal is that, let's say today I'm 50, but when I turn 75, I have enough money to beat the rising prices. So short term goals have to be in very safe investments. Medium-term goals should be in moderate risk investments, because you don't want a goal to happen on a day and then that day if we call up and say that today COVID has happened, I can't give your money at the same value. You can't compromise on your goal. And a very long-term goal should be in equity products. So fixed income, hybrid, equity, these are the three simple framework. For a retail investor, there are so many choices that it confuses you. But if you just keep this alignment, building a portfolio to your goal, not to the views of the market, because views are seasonal, they change every day. Goals are not seasonal, they are permanent.